I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the unfamiliar sting. Try to kill.
Yeah, I'm sure the listeners will like that song, whatever that song may be. I'm Steve Schiefschinder, and this is Delusions of Granular, recording from a location where it's kinda raining like Camino, and what better to do on a rainy day than to get granular with Star Wars. We're gonna be talking about the first arc of the Darth Vader series. Once again, broad review before spoilers. But first, just to let everyone know, our website is delusionsofgranular.com. You can also find us on Stitcher and iTunes, you know, write a review, tell your friends. You can follow us at SWDOG77 on Twitter, or go to facebook.com/SWDOG. You could also send us an email at SWDOG77@gmail.com. And maybe we'll read it on the show. Or you could even leave us a message by calling 651-337-9364. So anyway, we're talking about the first arc of the Covenant, I mean comic series, Darth Vader, by Kieran Gillen. Not to be confused with Karen Gillen from Doctor Who and Guardians of the Galaxy. The only other works by him I've read are the first issue of Wicked and Divine from Image Comics and the Free Comic Book Day issue of Mercury Heat from Avatar Press. The former is a fantasy story about gods who reincarnate as rock stars, and the latter is a sci-fi story about a tough law enforcer on Mercury. Neither of those really grabbed my attention, and I'm not sure if I'll ever revisit them. But I feel like Gillen did a really good job writing Darth Vader. It's kind of the opposite of how I feel about Mark Waid, whose apocalyptic superhero comic series Irredeemable I prefer over his Princess Leia comics. For Darth Vader, Gillen drew inspiration from I, Claudius, The Godfather, and House of Cards. I'm not a huge fan of The Godfather and haven't experienced the other two titles, but if they contributed to the good stuff in these comics, like the intrigue that's ever-present, then good on them. The series is essentially the story of how Vader overcomes his failure of preventing the Death Star's destruction, and how he gains more power between A New Hope and The Empire Strikes Back. In the former, he seems to be on a leash and follows the orders of Tarkin, whom he respects. With Tarkin dead and Palpatine mad, Vader has a lot of work to do before becoming this all-powerful figure whom we see in The Empire Strikes Back. And he is very ambitious in these comics. I'm convinced that he would be sorted into Slytherin if he went to Hogwarts. Salvador La Roca does a great job translating characters from films to the screen. There are even flashbacks to the film that resemble those scenes very well. Although, this flashback sequence also has Luke's face drawn in a really weird way. He's holding his lightsaber with his eyes closed, and his mouth with his teeth showing is open in a very strange way that might distract readers from the intensity of the sequence. But for the most part, he does a great job with the art. The first arc of the series is simply titled Vader, and I wonder whether or not a better title could have been thought up. It's weird saying, I'm gonna read Darth Vader, Vader. This story arc takes place during the second half of Star Wars Skywalker Strikes by Jason Aaron. More specifically, Vader Part 1 takes place between Skywalker Strikes Parts 3 and 4, and then the rest is parallel until Part 6 of both series show the same ending. While one could read Skywalker Strikes without having the twist in The Empire Strikes Back spoiled for them, Vader is very heavy with the prequel references that spoil that twist. So that twist could be preserved for new fans living in a bubble if they only read Star Wars, Skywalker Strikes, and Showdown on the Smuggler's Moon. But then it gets complicated when you get to the Vader Down crossover and see the perspectives of both the Rebels and Vader. This first arc does a great job building off of Skywalker Strikes while also taking its own path. What's weird is that the first two issues of Skywalker Strikes came out before Vader issue 1, and Skywalker Strikes part 3 came out later, even though it takes place before Vader. And Vader parts 2, 3, and 4 came out before Skywalker Strikes part 4, even though that issue takes place before Vader part 2. So people reading these arcs after they have been completed will be less confused than people who are following them as they were coming out. And as I've said before, I liked this arc more than Skywalker Strikes, despite how good that was. While Vader is the titular character, and therefore the main focus, there are some new secondary characters for him to bounce off of. Some of the new characters may feel hit and miss, and they also feel like mirror universe versions of familiar characters. I guess that readers might compare them to characters seen in fanfiction. And I know that there are fans who would call the Legends stories licensed fanfiction, as if to insult those stories, which are not all bad. I would say that not all fanfiction is bad. Admittedly, I haven't read a lot of fanfiction, let alone Star Wars fanfiction, but some fanfiction is good. I've read a fan's alternate version of the prequel trilogy, and it was written well. So I'd say stop using the word fanfiction as a dismissive term. I've heard the term fanlit, as in fan literature. Not sure how many people say it, but it sounds very respectable. So now we're gonna dive in issue by issue. I read a preview of the first few pages within issue 1 of Skywalker Strikes and had a problem right away that could have easily put me off of reading the Darth Vader series. Luckily, I stuck with the series, which is a good thing because of the quality and the overlap between the two ongoing series. I had a problem with Vader setting foot on Tatooine because I supported that school of thought that he never set foot on it because he would not have wanted to be reminded of his childhood and the death of his mother. And it was also a good reason for Luke to be hidden on Tatooine. This is something touched upon in Legends book Dark Lord, The Rise of Darth Vader, and it made sense. And of course, Vader would probably still hate sand. Anakin said, "I don't like sand. It's rough and coarse and irritating, and it gets everywhere." However, it seems implied that this is the first time going there since his past life as Anakin Skywalker, and he has no choice since the orders come from his master, Emperor Palpatine. So I can accept Vader never going to Tatooine until this moment when the Emperor feels the need to punish him. He even tells him that it should be a sentimental trip, as if to taunt him. Judging from Vader's assault on a random group of Tusken Raiders, he still harnesses a strong hatred for those people after what happened to his mother. It is also evident that Vader and Sidious are keeping secrets from each other. On one hand, Sidious is having meetings with a stranger whose right eye is a Rodian eye. On the other hand, Vader knows that the one who destroyed the Death Star is using the lightsaber that he used to have. One irritating thing about the Darth Vader series is that since Luke's name remains unknown to the Empire in general, they refer to him as the pilot who destroyed the Death Star. Why not just call him Death Star Killer? It's accurate, and it's a nice reference to Luke's surname in early drafts of Star Wars. But anyway, Vader visits Jabba the Hutt, not making his son's mistake of stepping on the trapdoor, and also nearly strangling the Hutt to death with force choke. And, of course, this brings to mind what his daughter does to him in Return of the Jedi. So, you know, as Buzz Lightyear would say, ring theory everywhere. You know, history and Star Wars, it rhymes. So Vader tells Jabba that he is visiting unofficially and will return the next day in his official capacity, which we see in Skywalker Strikes Part 4. But in the meantime, he asks for Jabba's best bounty hunters, which end up being Boba Fett and Black Kersantan, the latter being a black-furred Wookiee. So Boba Fett and Black Kersantan are hired to get Luke Skywalker and the stranger whom Palpatine meets with, respectively. It seems rather obvious that Fett and Kersantan are meant to represent like a flip side of Solo and Chewbacca, but it is nice to see a Wookiee villain for a change. I find it interesting that he is willing to do a job for someone of the Empire, since the Empire has done bad things to Kashyyyk and its Wookiees. I would also like to say that I think that this issue debunks the theory floating around online that Fett was hired to kill Owen and Beru. This is clearly Vader's first time meeting him, as he asks him if he's Jabba's best. And we see in Episode 5 that the Empire is reluctant to hire bounty hunters, and it's Vader who goes through with gathering them to search for the Millennium Falcon. So, Owen and Beru were killed by stormtroopers, as Lucas wants us to believe. If he wanted us to believe otherwise, he would have made a revision pointing all signs to Fett. So, Fett killing Owen and Beru didn't happen. Now, on to issue 2 of Vader. If you are one of those fans who is trying to forget the prequels, then Darth Vader is relatable here because that's precisely what he is trying to do. He encounters a pirate ship whose crew is defended by what appears to be a new breed of droidicas. Needless to say, these destroyers are destroyed by Vader. He is also willing to destroy an astro droid after it has uploaded the data he requires and he frames someone, if I recall correctly. He then remarks, "Droids. One can always trust droids." This final ominous sentence is multi-layered. On one hand, Anakin Skywalker spent the Clone Wars fighting armies of droids. On the other hand, he classified astrodroid R2-D2 and beloved protocol droid C-3PO as his friends. So, Vader might have purged lingering attachments to droids like these. I mean, we see him shoot R2 in the trench run on the Death Star, but with his line actually being a form of foreshadowing, that is not to say he does not still have a need for droids, as we find out in the next issue. So, in the next issue, we are introduced to Dr. Aphra. She is a raider who salvages machinery across the galaxy, and she is a walking homage to Indiana Jones. She even escapes a droidica, much how Dr. Jones escapes the boulder in Raiders of the Lost Ark. Darth Vader has come to her for help, thus starting a fascinating dynamic. Though she has a habit of speaking a lot while Vader is silent, she is still nervous about him. This is revealing when Vader lights his lightsaber, but she is able to conceal her fear on the surface. Luckily, Vader needs her to obtain resources. What he is searching for is a completely loyal army. There are droidicas and super battle droids in this issue. Like, again, this series does a really good job of blending the prequel era with the original trilogy era. Vader heads to a droid factory on Geonosis. In addition, there is a protocol droid called 000, whose functions include torture in addition to translation, and there's a homicidal astro droid called BT-1, who was part of something called the Tarkin Initiative before A New Hope. So they're on their way to Geonosis, but before I get to that, I'd just like to say I would love to see BT-1, as well as Chopper from Rebels in Rogue One. I'd even prefer seeing them over seeing Vader in the movie, to be honest. I mean, just imagine Chopper having a cameo at a Rebel base, and BT-1 firing his machine gun-like weapon at the Rebel soldiers. That'd be a neater tie-in than a TIE fighter. So in issue 4, Vader gets to Geonosis, where he encounters a Geonosian queen who, unable to reproduce biologically, has created droids whom she considers to be her children, which is odd, but I think it's an interesting insight into her character. This might be the same Geonosian queen from the Clone Wars, but I'm not 100% sure. Luckily, Vader and Aphra have droids on their side. The flamethrower-wielding astro droid BT-1 and the torture enthusiast protocol droid 000. The setting does, of course, remind Vader of the kiss shared with Padme prior to entering the arena in Attack of the Clones. And I love how Aphra is intelligent enough to know the risks of working with Vader. She knows that there is a chance that he may kill her when the job is finished, and even tells him how she wants to be killed if it does happen. Luckily, Vader believes that she is still of use. Regardless, she reiterates that it is unwise for him to let her live and that he should kill her with his lightsaber when the time comes. Once again, we see Black Kersantan, who has brought Vader the stranger hired by Emperor Palpatine. As he is tortured and killed off-screen, or off-page, I guess, his name is revealed to be Dr. Silo 4. Vader then learns about the location of his supposed rivals, whom Palpatine is considering to replace him. So in issue 5, Vader has his droid army, and he takes it to a base, which is on the back of a flying celestial beast, and it looks freaking awesome. It looks like it's carrying a city on its back, and it looks really cool. The concept reminds me of Terry Pratchett's Discworld. It feels like more of the organic fantasy side of Star Wars, which has also been touched upon in the Clone Wars. Vader gets on board with his battle droids, as well as 000 and BT-1. We see a bit of a banter between the protocol droid and the astro droid. Then, it seems as if Vader is facing two Jedi who may have survived the Purge, but it turns out that they are neither Jedi nor Sith, just young, Force-sensitive twins. Yes, twins. Always with the twins in Star Wars, but what can you do? We find out later in the series that the sister's name is Aeolin Astarte, I'm not sure whether or not the E at the end is supposed to be pronounced, and her brother's name is Morit Astarte or Astarte. Sidious shows up so that he may witness Vader fighting off more rivals who could replace him. There's even a Trandoshan in there somewhere. But, of course, we know that Vader makes it out alive. So, final issue, Vader defeats these rivals, and we find out that Sidious has been looking to replace him ever since he became a cyborg. It is also revealed that, though Silo 4 is dead, An identical body called Silo 5 is carrying on the scientists' work. So it's very sci-fi in nature. It's like something that you'd see in Star Trek. So Sidious's activities have understandably upset Vader, who is now forced to work with a group of the Emperor's minions, including Mon Calamari cyborg Commander Carbon, whose design was inspired by General Grievous, according to Silo. Carbon just looks really awkward. It's essentially Grievous's body with a Mon Calamari head. And I'm not talking about Grievous's original organic Kalish body. I mean, like, his droid body with a Mon Calamari head. I wonder whether or not Galen was playing with Star Wars Legos one day and then decided to just put Ackbar's head on Grievous's body. It's like Carbon was designed to be hated by the readers, which I could see being intentional. There's also a scientist with cybernetic implants on her head and goggles on her eyes, and her name is Toulon Voidgazer. And she admired Tarkin's work, apparently. Her surname, Voidgazer, sounds very much like a Tatooine name, like Skywalker, Darkrider, or Fardreamer, or even Windrider, though that was the name of an Imperial from Alderaan in the novel Lost Stars. The end of the issue, and the arc as a whole, contains the ending of Skywalker Strikes Part 6. Boba Fett informs Vader that the pilot who blew up the Death Star is named Skywalker. So, it's the same scene from the end of Skywalker Strikes, but this time we get flashbacks from Vader's point of view. So, as evidenced by flashbacks to Revenge of the Sith, my guess about Vader being very angry at Sidious at the end of Skywalker Strikes is correct. So, we see Sidious delivering the news about Padme in the flashback, in which he says, "I'm afraid she died. It seems, in your anger, you killed her." Interestingly, the first sentence does not appear in the film itself, but appears in the novelization. So it makes me wonder whether or not Vader's memory is reliable. And there's also a flashback to Vader's confrontation with Luke on Simoon 1 in Skywalker Strikes. And Luke has that awkward, cringe-worthy face I mentioned, which could interrupt the flow of this flashback. So Vader then contacts Sidious, informing him that he will not fail him. I just love how Vader's realization that he has a son has reinvigorated him with power. It's a great start, this whole arc, and it got me hooked on the series. So, that's my review of Darth Vader, Vader, and I'll be sure to review the next couple of arcs when I'm able to. But before then, I think I'll review the second volume of Star Wars, which is Showdown on the Smuggler's Moon. So be sure to check that out, and check out the rest of our episodes on the website. You know, some of them have me, some have Ron and JP. They're a lot of fun. So check those out. And with that, I'll play myself out. So, yeah, this song that I can clearly hear, that I'm hearing as I record this. Definitely not edited onto the episode. Alright folks, stay granular and may the force be with you.